Welcome to the Ben Greenfield Fitness Show. I'm Ben Greenfield, of course. Who else would I be? This is my show. Today, I'm interviewing these folks who created this device I've been using in my house for, of all things, DNA repair. It's actually a very, very interesting show with this guy named Hans Eng. Hans Eng. It's a pretty badass name, if you ask me. This podcast, as all podcasts from the Ben Greenfield Fitness Show, I'm just going to keep on saying that because I'm narcissistic and like to say my own name, is brought to you by my company, Kion, K-I-O-N, which you can check out over at getkion.com. One of the things that we have over there that I don't think a lot of people know about is this extremely hypoallergenic, super effective skin serum. It's got 12 different organic ingredients in it. I spent a couple of years formulating all these ingredients, studying exactly what it is that can repair scars or get rid of wrinkles or increase the color and the tone of your skin. So it's got things like aloe vera and jojoba. Never know if I'm pronouncing that right. A wild oregano oil, lavender, geranium, palmarosa, turmeric, juniper berry, organic lemon extract. You can even put this stuff in your hair for a bit of added shine and shimmer, like one of those old Pantene Provine shampoo commercials where you can swing your hair around. It's all sexy. Anyways, it's called Kion Serum. You can get this or any of the other fine products that I formulate over at getkion.com. Just like it sounds like, Get Kion. How do you spell Kion? K-I-O-N. Getkion.com. This podcast is also brought to you by the best tasting green superfood juice on the face of the planet, Organifi Green Juice. I literally just had it in my smoothie this morning. I did bone broth, collagen, I did a little cacao powder, which I also got from Organifi, and then the Organifi green juice. I blend all that up, and today I put some frozen blueberries and some walnuts in there. It was amazing. This green juice has a ton of ingredients in it. They've put adaptogens in it. They've put ashwagandha in it, which is fantastic for lowering your cortisol and increasing your testosterone. They kind of went all out on this green juice, and there's no mess and there's no cleanup. And you get 20% off. It's very simple. You go to Organifi.com. That's Organifi with an I, Organifi.com, and you use code Greenfield, and that automatically gets you 20% off of their green juice, their red juice, their cacao, you name it, anything you want over there. Also, this podcast is brought to you by Gainswave, which is this breakthrough way that guys and girls can optimize their sexual performance, get better orgasms, get better blood flow to the nether regions. It's very simple. I do this, I've been doing about 4 times a year. Go down there, and they've got 80 different clinics all over the country. They actually just put a clinic in Spokane, Washington, so I might start doing it even more frequently. But they do sound wave frequency. It's this acoustic sound wave frequency that they blast your crotch with, and it causes the growth of new blood vessels, and it breaks up old blood vessels. You get more oxygen and nutrients, and it's this special patented waveform that they use. They do a whole bunch of other therapies, but this acoustic sound wave therapy, it's amazing. You feel like you're taking, I mean, if you're a guy, you feel like you're taking Viagra or Cialis for the next couple of months. It's really crazy, but there's no drugs, there's no pills, there's no pharmaceuticals, just this 20-minute sound wave therapy treatment. Check in, check out, boom, done. That's it. You can learn more or find a provider near you if you go to gainswave.com/Ben. And if you mention me or the show, you save 30% off your first treatment. So that's gainswave.com/Ben. In this episode of the Ben Greenfield Fitness Show,
when you produce ATP, you're producing unavoidable a damaging component that damage proteins. Yeah? So the combination of bringing more oxygen for the ATP production into the body and supporting with our technology the repair of proteins that are now able then to use ATP for the peripemic direction are pretty perfect. in the connection with cancer, one area that we definitely see how it is used, and that is for the regeneration during and after cancer therapy.
He's an expert in human performance and nutrition. Voted America's top personal trainer and one of the globe's most influential people in health and fitness. His show provides you with everything you need to optimize physical and mental performance. He is Ben Greenfield.
Power. Speed. Mobility. Balance. Whatever it is for you, that's the natural movement. Get out there. When you look at all the studies done, studies that have shown the greatest efficacy.
All the information you need in one place, right here, right now, on the Ben Greenfield Fitness Podcast.
Hey folks, it's Ben Greenfield, and I have sitting on my desk right in front of me this really cool device. You may have seen me post about it on Facebook or Snapchat or Instagram if you follow me on any of those channels. And it's got this strange, like, blue light generating water canister on the top of it, and then a nasal cannula and a tube that come out of it. And while I sit here and I work during the day, I breathe the air that comes out of this thing. It's called a Nano V, made by a company called Life Science Technology, ENG3 Life Science Technology, out of Washington State. And it's a fascinating device that supposedly repairs DNA damage and generates some kind of a signal that actually, I should shut up and have the scientist on the show talk to you about this, because I've got a guy who can explain this a lot better than I can. And that's actually why I wanted to get him on the show, because all I know is I feel amazing after I use this thing, whether it's before exercise or just during the day. But I have yet to wrap my head around kind of the full story behind how this crazy contraption works. So I figured I'd get a biophysicist on the call. And his name is Hans Eng, and he's the president and the CEO of ENG3 Corporation, which is the Seattle-based company that uses biophysics technology to make these very interesting medical devices. And he has over three decades of experience with advanced medical technologies, both domestically and abroad, and has his mechanical engineering degree from Berlin, Germany, combined with a background in material science and proteomics. So, Hans, welcome to the show, man.
Yeah, Ben, welcome. Thank you for having me here.
Yeah, it's a beautiful German accent that you have there.
Thank you very much for the introduction, and you used a lot of keywords which are describing the background of our technology and which are describing parts that we are utilizing within the technology. And you were asking about where everything comes from and what it is doing. Let me see if I can translate this in a very fast way to your listeners.
Actually, you know what? Can I interrupt you before you even start to explain that? Because I want to know more about you, man. I mean, you're a biophysicist, but you seem to have this interest in repairing DNA damage, like in these medical technologies that are doing things that I wasn't familiar medical technology could do. Is this something you've always been interested in? Have you always been kind of interested in, like, the human body and medical science, how'd you actually get interested in this?
Yeah, that is basically my background. I studied material science in Germany, and part of the material science during this time were also, very soft materials. Proteins are soft materials. They have a different kind of binding energy to build their crystal structure and their final structure. And with this knowledge, I started to work in medical device companies, at first in human implant technologies, so companies are building artificial bones, artificial joints.
one of the company in Berlin, which further got bought by Johnson & Johnson. I worked in the R&D department, and the surface structure, how those kind of artificial joints and bones being accepted by the body involved cell biology. And so cell biology was an important part of this kind of area. You had to know how the body works. And during this time, cell biology was not really high developed as it is today. And we had to study and to learn a lot of things, how the cells are actually working. And we were pretty mechanic, everything. My department where I worked in, and we were mainly interested in how do proteins work. Because proteins in our body are the workhorses. The proteins in our body do everything, not in the human body only, in every body of a living species. The proteins are the key part. The proteins are built out of amino acids. 50% of the amino acids that we need for our life are produced in our body, by our body. The other 50% we have to take in by food. Mm-hmm. And these, the small number of in the 20s amino acids, these amino acids are being used during the gene expression to create more than 900,000 different proteins in our body. So 900,000 different proteins in our body, some by them, only by one protein, sometimes in a big protein network, are working in our body and execute function. Some of those proteins we know, insulin, is one. Yeah, we know a lot of enzymes. We know that we need enzymes for digestion. We know that we have hormones, which are protein growth hormones. And so most of these 900,000 proteins, we don't know. We know something about maybe 30,000 proteins. Their structure, we don't know. Their size, they are having very short lifetime. And we have more than 10,000 of different proteins in a cell, in one cell, and they are running every... And a very protein-like molecule in our cells are the DNA. The DNA actually is not a protein, but a protein-like structure. And hold together by hydrogen bonds, which is a very weak bonding energy that makes them they're vulnerable. So things that happen to them could destroy, could damage a protein, could damage a DNA, and then you will lose this kind of function. And as we know, today, all chronic diseases that we have is nothing else than a loss of certain protein function. We don't know which one, but we know that the loss of those protein functions finally end in a chronic disease. And the accumulation of lots of protein functions are basically causing the aging. And at the end, when we lose most vital protein functions, we are dying.
Now, what do you mean when you say that a loss of protein function is associated with chronic disease? Like, can you give an example?
Yeah, for example, diabetes. We know that insulin is involved in a diabetes. That a dysfunction in the insulin production could cause diabetes. We know that a certain kind of other apoptosis function, that means the programmed cell death, when that is getting lost, that it causes cancer. And a lot of other COPD, Alzheimer, chronic diseases, cardiovascular diseases are all related to protein functions that are getting lost.
Yeah, I think it's interesting. You know, have you ever heard of Aubrey de Grey?
Not very intensively.
Okay. He's this guy who has the SENS Research Foundation, and they research longevity and specifically the reasons that people get chronic disease or the things that one could do to enhance anti-aging. And I interviewed him on the show, and he has like seven different proposed reasons that aging damage occurs. And he for each of those seven reasons, like every single one has to do with proteins, right? So mutations, right? Like changes to nuclear DNA that contain genetic information or proteins that bind to the DNA.
Yes.
Junk, right? Like cells constantly breaking down proteins. And there's this buildup of literally harmful junk protein that accumulates outside of cells, like amyloid plaque in Alzheimer's patients. Cells secreting proteins that might be mutated or might be harmful. That's basically known as like cellular senescence, right? Or cells that are cross-linked, right? Extracellular protein cross-links, he calls them, where cells are held together by special linking proteins. And when too many cross-links form, the tissue loses elasticity, and that causes, like, for example, arteriosclerosis in vessels or fibromyalgia in muscle tissue. And so I think it's interesting. You're talking about proteins and chronic disease, and when I interviewed him, like, you know, every single reason that people get old is basically because of DNA damage or some kind of protein damage or buildup of junk proteins. You're kind of speaking the same language as him. And by the way, for everybody listening in, I'm going to put show notes to this. I'll link to that podcast I did with Aubrey, but I'll link to everything else Hans and I discussed. Just go to bengreenfieldfitness.com/DNA repair. That's bengreenfieldfitness.com/DNA repair. So Hans, sorry to interrupt you, but I believe you're talking about like how DNA actually gets damaged.
Yes. So by knowing that all these problems, yeah, and the aging itself, is an accumulation of protein damage. Yeah? We are very interested. How is it possible to do something against it? Yeah? So we know that a lot of possibilities or ideas are out there to prevent damage, so to avoid that damage happen. Yeah? But then we have to look a little bit on the facts. What are the mechanisms that is doing this damages? And when we look at this, I think there is basically not a big thing to do to protect them, yeah? Because the biggest damaging event in the cells are actually caused by a very important process that has to occur in the cell. Now, that is the ATP production, the energy production in the cell is utilizing oxygen, but is producing as a side effect, an unavoidable side effect, free radicals. These are the reactive oxygen species. We are producing per day about 650 quadrillion free radicals, a normal breathing person. If you're an athlete and if you're doing endurance sport, you can easily have 100 times more of this amount of damaging molecules in your cells. That is unavoidable. And these damaging molecules have only mainly one group of other partners they can find that will connect with each other in the cells, and these are the proteins. So they are 10,000, 30,000 different proteins in cells are getting damaged. The DNA is per day damaged far more than 100,000 times.
Wow.
And these changes have to be repaired. Yeah? And our body is stable. And in biology, there is a process that is enabling the repair. And as fast as it is repaired, as better the system stays healthy, you can perform further, because you're not losing functions, you're not losing abilities to generate your cell ATP, for example, your cell energy. So we were not interested to avoid the damaging process. We are interested to support the repair process.
The repair process. So you're not trying to stop the damage. You're basically like a better strategy for people rather than limiting the damage would be to just repair the damage that's going on.
Yes.
Why wouldn't you want to stop the damage and do the repair at the same time?
That is your choice. I mean, that is a choice of the person itself. I can try to avoid a certain lifestyle. I can try to avoid a certain way how I eat, how I work, what I do.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I mean, you're not saying like go have a Big Mac and supersized fries every day and then like breathe into your special device to repair the DNA, right?
Right, but some people do this. They have a lifestyle, for example, they have a really demanding lifestyle. If you have a very stressful job, demanding job, yeah, you basically could say that you're running every day with your brain a marathon. Yeah?
Well, or if you are a marathoner or an Ironman triathlete or a CrossFitter or somebody like me who's beating up my body every day, I mean, I'm not eating junk food, but I am I'm putting my DNA, I'm bringing it to hell and back every day. And I know it, right? That's why we're talking, because I'm constantly figuring out ways to repair it.
Yes, yes. You as a person, or me as a person, I try to minimize the bad influence, the bad impacts, yeah? But our technology and our company, with our background, we try to offer a product that you can improve and boost your repair capacity on top.
Now, before you talk about the repair capacity, sorry to interrupt, but how does DNA actually mm-hmm. get repaired in the first place?
The DNA is being repaired by enzymes. A couple of years ago, people got Nobel Prizes. They could exactly show which kind of enzymes in a certain area of the DNA is involved in the repair. You could think about that these are little like a zipper. They are running up and down the DNA in a certain area. And they look if everything is okay. And if there's some breakage, they ask other proteins to repair this part. And if the breakage is too big, if the damage is too big, then the entire DNA is being discarded. The cell sometimes is being discarded and a new cell is being initiated. Yeah? So you have a replacement of a broken cell. And here you see when those proteins, for example, got damaged, because the damage does happen to every protein or could happen to every protein in the cell. If those protein repair proteins damaged, then the repair actions or control mechanism to look for damage on DNA cannot happen anymore. Now you have a broken DNA. In the next gene expression, you get a wrong blueprint for the next generation of proteins. And now you start to run bigger problems in the cycle because the proteins that the DNA is initiating during the gene expression, the proteins have failure, and now you run in bigger health problems.
Okay, got it. So basically, when you're looking at DNA repair, and you're saying these enzymes are assisting with DNA repair, essentially enzymes are like removing incorrect bases and then replacing them with the correct bases. And that's essentially going to take care of replication mistakes in the DNA that would result in mutations that would then result in things like mitochondrial deficits or accelerated aging or an increased rate of telomere shortening, et cetera.
Right.
Okay.
Right. Yeah. All right. So if the DNA is not being repaired, you have a major blueprint damage for our next generations of proteins in the cell.
Okay, got it. So at this point, when it comes to DNA repair, one of the things that when I first looked into this device that I kept seeing over and over again on your website was this concept of reactive oxygen species, like or ROS as we call them. Where do ROSs fit in when it comes to DNA damage and DNA repair? Like, why is that something you talk about so much?
Yeah, we have to start to explain the technology on a level that's commonly known. So if we would jump right away in the process, what we are doing in the device, there would be a big gap between what the majority of people know already and what we say. So we have to get a little bit more to the beginning. And you mentioned that our technology is called bioidentical signaling technology. Also, that is a kind of group name. So we have to explain where the signal is coming from. And here we have to go to the source. And the source of the signal of this process are a very specific kind of reactive oxygen species. So reactive oxygen species, there are many different which are produced by the mitochondria during the ATP production. They are released in the cell, and we have a lot of information, a lot of paper out there that describes the redox signaling process and the damaging process of free radicals, but also now we have since many years all the important repair processes which are triggered by the reactive oxygen species. There's a lot of material out there.
So reactive oxygen species can trigger repair.
A very, very specific mechanism out of a very specific group from the reactive oxygen species is responsible for the repair, to trigger the repair. Yes.
Okay.
And these very specific reactive oxygen species is called activated oxygen, And to describe it, it is when you inhale the molecule, and in the ATP, the molecules are getting ripped apart, the oxygen molecules. Sometimes an electron is getting pulled a little bit further to the outside. And when this kind of atom is released into the cell, the electron jumps back on the preferred distance to the center. And when that happens, a very specific electromagnetic energy is being emitted by this electron. Yeah? So that is a common process in all materials that we know so far in the universe. Yeah? You put energy in, removing, that is moving the electron further to the outside. That is called you excite the material. And when you stop to put the energy in, the so-called excitation energy that was absorbed is being released again, is being emitted in form of material-specific electromagnetic energy.
Okay, so basically, if I could interrupt really quickly, when you're talking about reactive oxygen species, specifically when it comes to DNA repair, what you're saying is that the process of the production of ATP is causing free radicals, and that certain reactive oxygen species, and I know reactive oxygen species could be things like nitric oxide or hydrogen peroxide or, you know, hydroxyl radicals or superoxide or all these different so-called antioxidants. You know, a lot of people think reactive oxygen species are bad. Many of them act as antioxidants. Those are essentially mopping up the free radicals, mopping up the cell membrane, the DNA damage, the mitochondrial damage, and the protein damage that can occur through normal cellular metabolism. And what you're saying is what you're trying to do is create somehow more of these good reactive oxygen species.
No.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now I feel like an idiot. Thank you.
No.
Okay. So I'm just kidding. Go ahead and explain this.
Yeah. The lot of different reactive oxygen species are being produced in the cells, yeah, and they are involved in the damaging process. Yeah, some of them are getting filtered out by antioxidants. Yeah, but there is one very specific reactive oxygen species that is an activated oxygen. Yeah, and oxygen is in this activated state. It is a free radical. Yeah, it has to emit its excitation energy. Yeah. And then it goes after emitting the excitation energy, it goes ahead and is doing the bad thing, yeah? Or it is connecting with an antioxidant and is being neutralized. Yeah? But the emission of the electromagnetic energy in the cell is an unavoidable process that happens in every oxygen species. We can measure it. Yeah? Today, we can have measurement instruments that we can measure how much of this kind of electromagnetic energy somebody is producing, or a plant is producing. So that was one of the breakthroughs in the last several years, in the last 30 years, yeah, that we were able actually to build so small sensors that we could measure this emission. Electromagnetic energy is, in this case, is not a visible light. We cannot see this, which basically means we are not glowing in the night. But the electromagnetic energy is the oxygen-specific energy. And if we look in Wikipedia or any other school book today, even in high school books sometimes, they teach the students what is the wavelength that this kind of excited oxygen is emitting. And with the right sensors, you can measure it when you're precise enough. So, and this electromagnetic energy is being used in the cells to repair, or better, to form, to create the three-dimensional structure of the proteins. Yeah?
What you're saying is that you're not making more of these good reactive oxygen species. What you're doing is you're simulating the same electromagnetic wave that they would produce.
Yes.
Okay.
That is absolutely correct.
All right.
Yeah. It is very difficult to produce a very precise free radical. Because the production of the free radical is very often a catalytic process that could create all kind of different free radicals. To be sure that you precisely only produce one kind that you want to produce is very difficult and very, very expensive to do. So that would not be available in a commercial thing. And because it is a catalytic process, it is also not very, it doesn't have a big outcome. Today we can do this instead with electronic devices. We have a very controlled process. We know exactly what kind of electromagnetic waves we want to produce, how many we would like to produce, and we have a permanently ongoing feedback system that tells us that we are actually producing it. Yeah? So in our devices, it's not possible that you have a device that doesn't work, yeah? Because it will always test itself. It will make sure that you get this, what we are planned to produce with this device.
Okay, so actually reactive oxygen species actually create a certain amount of electricity. They create an electromagnetic wave, and you're simulating that same electromagnetic wave, but you're doing so by somehow creating that electromagnetic wave with a water molecule rather than a reactive oxygen species molecule.
Yeah, the electromagnetic signal is an electronic process that we produce in it. Now we have to go back for a second back to the biology. We have to see what happens in the cells when this electromagnetic signal was produced, and how is it possible that the protein gets it and is utilizing it for its last formation into the three-dimensional shape. One thing is also that I would like to mention is we have a very good 3D animation video on our website that explains this entire process in a very, very, too.
I'll link to that video for people who aren't getting this via audio. I'll link to that video over at bengreenfieldfitness.com/DNA repair.
Yeah. So in the part of the biology, we have to look in is a process of protein folding. Protein folding is a thermodynamic process, it's a pure physical process, not a chemical process. And a protein that is built out of amino acids in a chain has to fold in a very, very specific form, and then it is functional. The last forming process, the thermodynamic one, needs energy. The surrounding of the protein, and that is water that surrounds the protein, needs to get in a higher energy state. And when that is enough for the protein that is surrounding it, then the protein will fold. Basically, it will use the energy, it will suck the energy out of the environment, able to make the next process to form into the three-dimensional shape, and is changing by doing it. It is changing its entropy. So this process is described since also around 20 years in the literature, in cell biology, and a very important part of this was a university in Washington, here in Seattle. There's a department for water science, and Professor Pollack in this department with a lot of other researchers.
I've interviewed Dr. Pollack before. He's extremely interesting. He's the guy that basically researches structured water and the idea that water carries a specific electrical charge that, when present, allows human cells to be able to better absorb that water, or the water to be able to better pass through vessels, like whether it be a plant or a human vessel.
Yes. That is one of those interesting thing what water can do when water is entering into the fourth phase. Yeah? And there are a lot of different things that the body is utilizing. Yeah? In this case, yeah, in our case, this kind of water structure means that the water that is surrounding the unfolded protein changes its structure by absorbing the electromagnetic energy. When another structure change happens to the water, the protein that is embedded in it will basically suck it out, will use it to change its entropy and form its final stage so that it works. Yeah? So this kind of folding process is absolutely essential for living species. Yeah? The proteins would never fold by itself into a three-dimensional structure if it wouldn't have the support by the water that is surrounding it. Yeah? So, and Professor Pollack, like I said, he describes in detail the material science that happens to the water. So when he described structured water in his books, in his publications, and you see worldwide, basically all big universities have somehow research departments in this area today. He described this in very good animations on websites and on other publications. The structure changes happens when water is able to absorb electromagnetic energy. It can only absorb very specific electromagnetic energy. And one of the electromagnetic energies that water is absorbing is exactly this energy that is emitted by the activated oxygen. Yeah? So now you see how things are falling together. Water is able to absorb an energy that is provided by the activated oxygen in the cells, and the embedded proteins in the water that absorbed it are now utilizing it for their folding process. Yeah? So as more of this kind of electromagnetic signal we have, as more of the structured water is being built around the protein, and as more is available in the cells, as more the proteins, as fast the protein can fold and repair itself.
That makes sense. So basically, you're producing this signal inside the device without producing any reactive oxygen species. I obviously spoke wrong a few minutes ago. You corrected me. So you're transferring that signal into water, basically into humidity. And then when someone breathes this humidified air, what happens is that same electromagnetic signal that would be produced by good reactive oxygen species, you're essentially just like sucking in through your lungs and your nose. It goes straight into protein repair, straight into DNA repair. And you guys have now been studying and doing research on how this actually works within the body. And you've found that it actually works. You found that it actually results in DNA repair.
Yes. That was one of our first studies to show and to prove that the effectiveness by using this technology will affect the proteins. And we took the biggest available protein-like molecule, and that is a DNA in the cell. There are test equipments out there, and we did it in Austria and in Germany. So an Olympic training center in Austria provided athletes only damaging their DNA. We took the blood. It was sent to a special company in Berlin. They were able to analyze the DNA damages. So we took the group of athletes. They did a hard training. And after the training, we draw the blood every day over a period of a week. We could realize how fast is the DNA being repaired without using our technology in this group of athletes. And then we let them rest for several weeks, and we did the same thing. And after the training, they used every day the NanoV device. Yeah? And we saw that the average repair improvement within a week was around 17 to 20%, which is a really big, high number in having support and faster DNA repair.
Wait, what are you measuring to measure DNA repair? What's the actual parameter you're measuring? It's not telomere length or something like that?
No, we are measuring the DNA directly.
Yeah? Okay.
So we measure how many DNA double strand breaks are still in the blood. Yeah? And then we compare the numbers after 1 week. That will show us then that the treatment with a NanoV technology, the people had around 17 to 20% less DNA breaks after 1 week than the same people who didn't use the NanoV.
Holy cow, I didn't even know you could measure DNA repair like that. That's crazy. It's very cool, though.
Oh, yeah.
It makes me feel good about using this thing. Hey, I want to interrupt today's show to tell you about Mind Pump. There are a lot of intelligent cats out there who I've had the privilege to talk to, and one of them is a triple board certified physician who I consider to be one of the most knowledgeable guys on the face of the planet, who is almost like an untapped resource in the health, nutrition, and fitness community when it comes to really, really cutting edge forward thinking.
I've had the privilege of hanging out with this guy, like, you know, backstage at conferences, and had my mind completely blown by the amount of knowledge that he has on everything from glyphosate and the gut to shockingly even things like political matters. He's a Renaissance man. That's the best way that I can describe him. He also is a fantastic athlete. His name is Zach Bush, Dr. Zach Bush. And recently, my friends over at Mind Pump interviewed him. They kind of took a dive into Zach's brain. And the guys at Mind Pump interview a lot of fantastic guests. But if you want to kind of get a flavor of Mind Pump, I'd recommend you go check out their interview with Dr. Bush. All of their guests are fantastic, but this would be one that I think would be right up your alley. They also do Q&A episodes, kind of like how I do when you hear me do a Q&A, but there's three of them, so it's three times as good as my Q&As. And they cover a wide range of topics, from testosterone enhancement to healing injuries to the latest supplements out there to fitness tactics. They're wonderful dudes. All three of them are my friends. Sal, Adam, and I don't remember the other guy's name. Justin. Anyways, though, so you can. I'm just kidding. I actually know the names of my buddies. I'm trying to make you guys laugh. Anyways, though, so Mind Pump. Here's how you find them. You go to iTunes, and you could just do a search for Mind Pump. You can find them there, or as they say nowadays, Apple Podcasts. Or you could go to mindpumpmedia.com, or you could just Google Mind Pump. Fantastic dudes. They are guys that I vouch for as being true icons in the fitness movement, and guys who get it when it comes to digging through all the confusion and the BS that we tend to find in our fitness world. So check them out. Mind Pump Media, mindpumpmedia.com, or go check them out in Apple Podcast. Google search for Mind Pump. You'll dig these dudes.
So there's a lot of people listening in who may not want to like repair DNA necessarily because of anti-aging goals, but some people might be more interested in, for example, exercise. Have you guys studied at all the effects of this on exercise performance?
Yes, we took another group of athletes at a different sport university in Vienna, and we measured their how fast they get rid after intensive training, how fast they get rid of the lactate, because the production of lactate in concentrated extreme sport is unavoidable, but we would like to get it out. The lactate reduction in the body is a complex protein function. As faster you get it out, as faster you can train again. And the same group, we used other markers. We used the inflammation response for these people, and where we see after the training that people have a higher inflammation, which is understandable because the heavy training damage cells, damage proteins, and the body has to react in form of inflammation to repair those things. So the inflammation markers should go up after training, and then go very fast, slow down, that would document the fast and the successful repair of damages in the cells. And we had the same thing, around 17% to up to 20% faster lactate reduction in the people, in the test groups, and around 17% to 20% improvement in the inflammation markers. And that was a blind, double-controlled study. So the people didn't use it, didn't know what they are being tested or if the NanoV devices were working or turned off. And it was, I think it was even published from the university. I don't really know. Yeah.
So if it's shutting down inflammation like that, should I be careful using this too soon after exercise? Like, wouldn't it potentially like blunt the hormetic response to exercise in the same way that like high dose antioxidants like vitamin C or vitamin E might actually blunt the hormetic response to exercise? Would this be something to avoid post-exercise, or is the mechanism of action different? And the reason I ask that is because I know that, for example, when you drink hydrogen-rich water or use one of these fancy new like hydrogen tablets, like that's something that can quell the inflammatory response without blunting the hormetic response to exercise. That's one thing I'm aware of that can do that. But I'm curious in terms of this, like, could it potentially quell the natural inflammatory process too much?
Mm-hmm. The inflammatory process after damage should be high. We would like to have damage being repaired, and inflammation is one stage, stage number two, in the repair status, in the repair mechanism. And that was what we saw, that the inflammation went down within a week, faster down than usual, is only because at the beginning it was higher. We had more repair right in the beginning after the damage, and then it faded out faster, and we had faster, no more inflammation at these people. Yeah? So it actually supports the biologic process of repair. Yeah? It is not suppressing anything. Because if you use, for example, a lot of antioxidants, after damage, you can suppress the inflammation. Yeah? And that is something that you don't want to do, because you would like to have the repair done and finished as fast as possible. Sometimes we know that the inflammation process comes with uncomfortable side effects. It can hurt. Yeah? You have a swelling, it can hurt. If you would like to suppress those things, then you use probably not our device. Yeah? You would use an antioxidant and every other things to stop the repair process. But that is not the usual way to go and the usual understanding of having a healthy life, to suppress inflammation. Mm.
What's the difference between this then and using an antioxidant?
Yeah, the antioxidant is trying in the body to catch free radicals that are produced in the cells, to catch them before they connect with other important components in the cell. So instead of having the free radical connecting with a protein and damages it, or having the free radical connecting with the DNA and damage the DNA, the body is producing by itself antioxidants, or we supplement our body with antioxidants so that these molecules are being now available for the free radicals to connect. Yeah? Mm. So that is a prevention one. But by knowing that the cells, or that the body produces 650 quadrillion free radicals, yeah, that is an extremely fast process. And when a free radical is being produced, it uses right away the next molecule that it can find. Yeah? It is not looking for where is my antioxidant molecule. Yeah? It grabs right away the next molecule. So there's always a very strong question about what happens when we do the antioxidant treatment. Is it really getting it to the free radicals, or is it something that the free radicals kind of ignore or could ignore and do their damage anyway? Yeah? So, and that's actually also that we see that too many antioxidants are causing other problems, yeah? Because they are interfering with other biochemical reactions in the cells, which we would like to have, which are biological important. But the free radicals, too many antioxidants are suppressing then, again, a very healthy cycle in the cells.
Okay, so if I understand this correctly, when we look at antioxidants that would be used in different processes within the body to eliminate reactive oxygen species or reactive oxygen species molecules, the antioxidant therapies would inhibit the oxidation that would be caused by reactive oxygen species by, like, basically more or less catching the ROSs, but yes, they eliminate not only the reactive oxygen species that would act as free radicals, but they also would eliminate the reactive oxygen species that would act as beneficial signaling molecules. And so if you take in a bunch of antioxidants, especially post-exercise, it's going to handicap cellular repair functions because it eliminates both the good and the bad reactive oxygen species. Whereas if you were to, for example, just breathe in via water the actual signal that the reactive oxygen species would be generating, you're going to get all of the beneficial aspects of taking an antioxidant without any of the detrimental aspects.
Yes. Yes. Okay. Yes.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. Now, what about these oxygen therapies, right? Like hyperbaric oxygen therapies or supplemental oxygen or exercise with oxygen therapy that would increase the percent of oxygen above normal levels. You know, a lot of people are using those. Is that going to be something that would affect this? Is this going to be something that you'd want to pair with a therapy like this because it's producing a lot of extra reactive oxygen species, or how does this compare to something like oxygen therapy, or how would you use it along with something like oxygen therapy? Because I personally have, I do exercise with oxygen therapy. So at certain times during the day, even like this morning, right? Like I did a 30-minute exercise session where I was using quite a bit of oxygen at a percentage high above normal levels.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Any oxygen treatment that is out there, it could be hyperbaric or it could be EWAT exercise with oxygen, yeah, they will all benefit by doing it together. The main focus for an oxygen treatment is to produce more ATP at the end, yeah, to bring oxygen through the breathing apparatus, through the transportation in the blood, to the mitochondria, where the mitochondria produces more cell energy, more ATP. Why do we want it? Because we know that all these protein-controlled functions in the body are using the ATP for the chemical reaction. Yeah? So basically, you said you can have a lot of nice working, correct working proteins in the cells. If you don't have the ATP, the fuel for the biochemical reactions, your body wouldn't work. Yeah? So you need the fuel. And the hyperoxygen or hyperbaric oxygen or the EWAT, these are systems, processes where you bring more oxygen to the ATP production and the biochemical reaction can start. As we heard in the beginning, when you produce ATP, you're producing unavoidable the damaging component that damage proteins. Yeah? So the combination of bringing more oxygen for the ATP production into the body and supporting with our technology the repair of proteins that are now able then to use ATP for the biochemical reaction are pretty perfect. Huh?
Okay, I got it. This is really interesting. So it looks like for kind of like a biohacker's lab, for example, like to put together the ultimate man cave like I have, and this is actually how I have it set up right now, just based on my own understanding of the topic, and I'm happy I have this set up the right way. I've got my Nano V device right here beside my desk. I have like my oxygen therapy device behind me, and I could, for example, work out on my oxygen therapy device, do my protocol on that, and then when I go to work at my desk later on, like later on in the morning, I can just hook this Nano V device up and use that to basically quell a lot of the reactive oxygen species that got generated from that oxygen therapy and then still get all the benefits from the oxygen therapy with none of the damage.
Yes.
Cool.
Yes.
I like it. Mm-hmm. I like it. Yeah. Awesome, man. So how long are you supposed to use this? Because that's something I don't have my head fully wrapped around. Can I use it? Because I've turned it on like a few times a day sometimes for like 30, 40 minutes. And other times I've used it for just 15 minutes. I mean, can you use it too much, or is it like kind of a, based on your own clinical research, a recommended period of time to use it for?
Yeah. One thing is how much time you have available. Yeah. Time is always an issue, and a lot of people are looking for, can I have it? Maybe I can have 20 minutes, half an hour time break slot somewhere. And therefore we have different devices where we have in the high-end devices, we can say use it 15 minutes per day. That would be a good start. Yeah. So to the upper side, yeah, how often can you use it maximum? Basically, you can use it 24 hours a day. Yeah. We are not introducing another component that is forced to be metabolized in your body.
Hold on. Based on what you've just told me, just a minute, you might hear a little bubbling noise. I'm turning it on right now. I'm gonna run this bad boy the rest of the podcast. Mm-hmm. There we go. Boom. Do you hear that little bubbling noise? Oops. I dropped something. Hear that bubbling noise? It's going right now. So if you guys hear like a little bubbling, it's pretty to look at too. We'll put a photo in the show notes. So now I'm breathing this air. So I can do this every day for as long as I want.
Yes. There's only one little thing, and that is very individual. If there is a lot of repair going on into your body, you can sometimes feel it. Yeah? And sometimes it also is uncomfortable for us, this repair. Yeah? And I have to... everybody knows, for example, that after a good party and the next morning, some people have the problem that they feel the repair that goes on in their head. So these kind of headaches, this repair process after those damages can be possible to feel it. That could happen also with the using the NanoVue device, especially in the beginning, when repair is higher than usual. We have never used the device, so you start slowly into it, and when you are setting up your body and your body is being used to it, then you can use it as much as you want, as long as you stay in your comfort level.
Okay, got it. So athletes could use this to accelerate the removal of lactic acid, or pre-workout to accelerate lactic acid buffering, and also to repair oxidative stress damage from exercise. People who are just trying to live longer, or who are using biohacking and using oxygen therapy, things like that, they could use it to quell some of the potential cellular damage and DNA damage that would be unavoidable from those activities. But have you studied this in any other situations aside from just like basic DNA repair, anti-aging, or in athletes? Are there other specific populations, like chronic disease populations or other people, that you found this would be especially beneficial for?
We have not studied on chronic diseases, because that is with FDA registration. Our product is an FDA registered product. In the moment we study and publish it on a specific disease, then the device can be only used with a specific disease and not anymore for something else. So we are not able, and we are not interested to study and to tailor this device only for one disease. This device is tailored to improve this protein repair. The rest is what a lot of people today know. Protein, damaged proteins are the cause for chronic diseases. And when you assist the repair of proteins, you probably will have a very beneficial outcome on a chronic disease.
Well, you probably can't say it because you'd get sued, but I can say it, that there's a very interesting paper on PubMed I found that talks about targeting DNA repair pathways for cancer treatment. And I thought that was very interesting. Obviously, cancer, as a lot of people know if they've listened to this podcast much, is a little bit of a metabolic mitochondrial disease more than it is what we've been led to believe in the past, just like pure genetic mutations gone awry. But regardless, once cancer has set in, it appears that DNA repair mechanisms can greatly affect the recovery from everything from like cytotoxic treatments like chemotherapy, for example, to a lot of the damage that tumors can create because more mutations in DNA can occur as tumors accumulate progressively, and a higher rate of DNA repair and protein repair could theoretically, and you don't have to say this, Hans, because I don't want you to get in trouble, but I would see this as being a pretty efficacious thing for cancer treatments as well. But obviously, as you've alluded to, health, general health, anti-aging, and athletic performance would be kind of like the big three that I'm seeing at this point that you guys can actually say this does work for based on research.
Yeah. Now, in the connection with cancer, there's one area that we definitely see how it is used, and that is for the regeneration during and after cancer therapies. When people are using it in this situation, they are not targeting, they are not focused on the cancer tissue itself. When you have radiation or chemotherapy gone to your body, you have a lot of damages, cellular damages on healthy tissue, which is a collateral damage during this process. If you are able to repair this still healthy tissue, to regenerate faster, to perform back to the normal again, then you have a chance to go through the entire cancer therapy so that the therapy itself will be successful. Whatever your doctor, your expert chooses for you, you have a faster regeneration during this time, and that is where we see where that is often be paired in a cancer treatment.
You know? Yeah.
Again, not treating the cancer, only treating the person who need the tissue area of the person that needs to regenerate faster, where you still have enough regeneration capacity in.
Yeah, well, I like this thing. I think it's amazing. And again, I've been using it for like the past 4 months, and I swear it's just so easy because I can sit at my desk and type and write and talk on the phone and talk to German biophysicists and be breathing my air at the same time. And yeah. I know you've got a few different models, like your eco model, where the standard time is 60 sessions. Then the one that's like twice as powerful, which is the pro device. I have the exo just cause I'm an overachiever, which is like four times more powerful than the base device. And that's what you'll find in a lot of homes, even professional settings. Like I know a lot of physicians are setting this up in their clinics. I think, my friend Dave Asprey has one down in Santa Monica to his biohackers lab down there. I know some chiropractic docs have them and athletes, of course. You guys have a whole host of athletes you list on your site who are now using this thing. And I'm one of those as well. So for people listening in, if you want to get access to a lot of the clinical studies that they've done on this, as well as their pricing, check out the website and access the show notes. And I'll also put an interview to my or a link to my interview with Aubrey de Grey, that longevity mm-hmm. interview that I mentioned. I'll also put a link to my interview with Gerald Pollack about the water in the show notes. Just go to bengreenfieldfitness.com/DNA repair. That's bengreenfieldfitness.com/DNA repair. Hans, I want to thank you for coming on the show and sharing all this stuff with us. I think this NanoV device is a game changer, and I get like I try out a lot of devices, dude. Like I try a lot of stuff. I shove a lot of stuff up my butt and in my nose and take a lot of different supplements and try out all these fancy devices, but this is one of the ones that has a hallowed place in my office. So thanks for designing this in your secret Batman labs over there in Seattle.
Yeah, okay. It's not so secret. You can come in here, visit us. Yeah, we are almost neighbors here in Spokane, and we are happy to share all this information and would guide you to other information too. Yeah,
awesome. Next time I want to visit 18 different Starbucks, I'll come over there to Seattle. So, thanks for coming on the show, man. I appreciate it.
Okay, thank you very much, Ben.
All right, folks. So I'm Ben Greenfield, along with Hans Eng from ENG3 Corporation. This device is called the Nano V. I'll link to it over at bengreenfieldfitness.com/DNA repair. And thank you for listening. Have an amazing week. And until next time, stay healthy. Breathe some electro-stimulated air. There you have it. All right, folks. Later.
You've been listening to the Ben Greenfield Fitness Podcast. Go to bengreenfieldfitness.com for even more cutting-edge fitness and performance advice.